They show Washington being attacked. That's almost.
Now, in fact, that ad played every 15 minutes. I'm sorry we couldn't show you all of it on stations all across Washington, D.C. So who's really behind it? Well, RT correspondent Jahan Hafiz is here with more. Now, Jahan, I just wanted to ask you, you know, this latest ad by the Israel Project, a lot of people are asking, where did it come from? How much money was put behind it? What did you find out when you were looking into it?
Well, of course, the Israel Project is behind this ad. They did not give me specific figures about how much they spent on this commercial, although they did tell me that this is something that has actually been around for quite some time. And they typically bring this commercial out whenever something sensitive is happening. So something politically hot popping off either in Washington, California, wherever it may be that's dealing with the Iran-Israel issue, they tend to have this thing running to influence either policymakers, you know, what have you, who are attending these summits. Now, some folks over at the Israel Project told me that they strategically had this commercial running consecutively throughout the 2 days of the summit, mainly to drive to world leaders, politicians, lawmakers, anyone attending the summit of influential status, that something more, you know, more punitive, decisive actions need to be taken to single out and isolate Iran in, because of its nuclear program. Now, as I mentioned, this, you know, commercial did pop up during the Democratic and Republican national conventions in 2008. It was also floating around Florida during a summit that was taking place down there. And it really is to bring about the Israeli perspective of Iran's nuclear program. And it was, you know, successful because there were a lot of people who did pay attention to it. As I mentioned, or maybe as you mentioned, it ran every 15 minutes on the hour on all the major news networks, which really go out to, you know, a wide variety of people here in the Washington Beltway, but also around the United States.
Now, earlier I was told that we actually have a clip that when you spoke to one of the people from the Israel Project. Do we still have that? I think we may have lost it.
Show Washington being attacked. That's almost crazy. That's almost impossible to conceive of. Our retaliation is there and will always be there, but even more, the Iranians don't have the missiles that could possibly reach Washington. They have them that could reach Israel, and of course that's the concern of the Israel Project.
So like we saw from the ad, not everybody necessarily was agreeing with this ad said. What else did you hear from some of the critics?
Well, that's true. That was Eugene Bird over at the Council for National Interest, and they actually counter the message of the Israel Project. And for the most part, you know, this commercial was aimed at journalists, media folks as well. But there were a lot of people in the media who were actually appalled by the message because they simply saw it as, you know, Iran is this trigger-happy terrorist-sponsoring state, and its wrath could be coming to a city near you, which, you know, is really heavily debated in that circle simply because, you know, the word propaganda was being thrown around among these groups who were critical of the commercial. And they just didn't see it as a very open kind of debate between the Israel-Iran issue, especially dealing with the summit. There were a lot of key players attending this past week, and there is also a lot of policies floating around Washington. So, you know, having PR stunts like this on the airwaves, and they're still, you know, going on right now, it's very influential for not just the politicians and, you know, the politically elite here in Washington, but it's also very influential among the American people. A CNN survey found that over 70% of the American people believe that Iran has a nuclear weapon, which, you know, is not true. But things like these that push that, that drive that message, and, you know, they're quite successful. They're actually getting their point across.
All right, Jahan, I want to thank you very much for looking into that for us.
Thanks for having me.
Now, this latest ad by the Israel Project is not the first of its kind, but it does bring up an interesting discussion. I mean, sure, Americans are used to political ads running on election years, but usually these ads are personality censored, local, referring to issues that matter to Americans at home. But how effective are ads that try to influence the average television viewer when it comes to foreign policy? Do we assume that more people here in Washington are watching their regular scheduled program and happen to see those advertisements? instead of people, the amount of people that actually watch the news to find out what the nuclear security summit was all about. Well, here to discuss it with me, I have media consultant Joel Silverman. Joel, thanks for being here. I want to reiterate what I just said. My assumption is probably that the majority of people that live in Washington, D.C., were just watching TV like usual. They probably weren't watching the news and wanting to find out every second what was going on at the nuclear security summit, even though 47 world leaders were here. Do we assume that more people saw this ad than watched the news?
Absolutely. Not a question. And ads are meant to influence. It was a saturation buy. A saturation buy is repeat the message, repeat the message, repeat the message, and a lot of people will hear the message. Not only that, but it gains traction because here we are talking about it. So not only did they get the ad, but they get the talk about the ad. Remember the Daisy ad against Goldwater? It was only played once, and then the news departments of every major network did the rest of the job, and Goldwater got defeated on a fear-based ad.
Well, like I said, this one was not only played once, this one was played every 15 minutes for 2 days, which was pretty intense. But do we think it's right? I mean, it's hard to say because what is it? It's advertising. But is it right for advertising to necessarily try to influence people on what they should think about foreign policy, especially in the terms of advertisements telling you that at any second you could be bombed?
Isn't that what Hill and Knowlton did when they represented the Kuwaiti Republic before the run-up to the first Iraq war? I mean, they spent millions of dollars in advertising to buy influence and get us to go to war. It's the same story. They've been buying influence for a while, and anyone can buy that influence. It's no different than a corporation.
Well, speaking of corporations, I'm happy you brought that up. I want to tie in the Supreme Court's Citizens United ruling here. Because technically, in this ruling, it's not for foreign corporations to pay for political ads, but we do know that if there is perhaps someone in a foreign country that sits on the board or somehow tied to these corporations, then they can easily throw money into it. So now that this ruling has passed, do we expect to see many more of these ads? Are we going to see ads, you know, coming in telling us about China, about Brazil and India?
I think we're going to see a lot more ads, and then we're going to find out whether or not they work. The real question is this just scatter shooting on behalf of people who know that advertising does work to sell products? But I'm not sure that you can sell foreign policy the same way you can sell Coca-Cola. And that's the real question. So does saturation advertising work? Obviously, repeating a message works. That's how lies get constantly put out. We talked about it a lot in media. That's the situation at Fox News. Tea parties are talked about from Fox and Friends in the morning until